symbol of ours. In the name of peace, we gather here now. Oh Lord, please make these days of ours on this earth filled with peace. Peaceful, peaceful.
Peace TV, peaceful, the solution for humanity.
Said, whoever calls to nationalism, to tribalism, is not of us, not a true Muslim. So Allah puts it on the same level. There is nothing special about people's colors because it exists everywhere. In fact, it is all from the greatness of Allah's creation.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Abu Amina Bilal Phillips. He was born in Jamaica, the West Indies, and grew up in Canada, where he accepted Islam in 1972. He completed a BA from the College of Islamic Disciplines at the Islamic University of Medina in 1979, and an MA in Islamic Theology in 1985 at the University of Riyadh College of Education. In 1994, he completed a PhD in Islamic Theology in the Department of Islamic Studies at the University of Wales. From 1994 to the year 2001, Dr. Bilal Phillips founded and directed the Islamic Information Center in Dubai, United Arab Emirates, and the Foreign Language and the Foreign Literature Department of Dar al-Fatah in the Islamic Press in Sharjah, again in the UAE. In 2001, Dr. Bilal Phillips established the Islamic Online University, the first accredited Islamic university on the internet. He was a professor of Arabic and Islamic studies at the American University in Dubai and Ajman University, head of Department of Arabic and Islamic Studies at Preston University in Ajman, again in the United Arab Emirates. He is a lecturer and director of Dawah and Education at the Qatar Guest Center in Doha, Qatar, and is currently the Dean of Islamic Studies Academy, again in Doha, Qatar. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome Bilal Phillips and invite him to the podium to begin his speech, Islam and Racism.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah. All praise is due to Allah. May Allah's peace and blessings be on the last messenger of Allah. This conference, Peace, the Solution of Humanity, has as a part of the issues it must address is that of racism being one of the major problems that humanity faces. Racism as a term is relatively modern. It wasn't known in the English language more than a few hundred years ago. It comes from the word race. And that word in itself is a new word. It refers to the major divisions of humanity based on particular physical characteristics. This is according to the Oxford Dictionary. And Oxford goes on to define racism as the belief that each race has certain qualities or abilities, giving rise to the belief that certain races are better than others. If we look into human history, among the ancients, racism was not really existent. You wouldn't find it in the writings, the hieroglyphic writings of ancient Egypt, or in ancient China, or in ancient India. Instead, what you found was family, tribal, or national superiority promoted. A nation or a tribe, having defeated other nations and tribes, considered themselves to be superior. They looked down on those people whom they defeated. And they would set up legal systems where the defeated peoples would be at the bottom levels of the society. In India, where the Aryans came into India and the Dravidians who were here ended up on the bottom level of the caste system, a religious, political, economic system, they ended up on the bottom because they were the defeated people. It so happens that the Aryans were of light complexion and the Dravidians were of dark complexion. So this is where there is an apparent link between what may be called the caste system and racism. In China, for example, the Chinese people, those tribes or races which they defeated and subjugated, they were held on lower levels in their society. They may have inducted them into the army and used them as a part of their workforce, but they didn't have a specific concept of color, for example, as being a distinguishing characteristic of race. Similarly, Egypt. The ancient record shows that the Egyptian people were a mixture, a blend of colors of people, and those people who became the slaves on the lower levels of the society were the defeated people. Whether they may have been light complexion people, like the people from the Syrians, from Iraq area, etc., or they were from the south, from the area we now know as Sudan, Ethiopia, these areas. So the people who they ruled over were of varying colors. They didn't themselves identify themselves based on color. So the rulers of ancient Egypt were of different colors. So it was more an issue of nation. You being an Egyptian, a born person of that nation, from that family or the tribes that created the Egyptian nation, you are superior to those nations that were defeated. In modern times, when this term of race and racism evolved in the English language and other languages, we find that it became a justification for European colonization of the world. As people spread out from Europe into Africa and into Asia, and they met with other civilizations, and they defeated these civilizations, they sought to ideologically identify these civilizations as being inferior to their own, and to justify their enslavement of these people and the destruction of their civilization. They developed this concept of race, racism, and supported it with the evolutionary theory. So if you see the writings in the 19th century of the evolutionists, or those who were promoting evolutionary theory, especially in the 19th century, and you see the charts which they created of human evolution, you'll see on the lower level of the charts, for example, apes, monkeys, chimpanzees, baboons, And then after that, you will see black peoples, peoples whose skin complexion were black. Then after that, then there were Chinese people. And then after that were the Yuan people who were at the top of the evolutionary tree. That's how they portrayed it. So this was a part of an ideology used to justify the subjugation of these people, that they may be elevated through that subjugation. And in time, of course, it produced some of the most worst examples of racism in history, whether in the United States of America, and I'm sure you're all familiar with the various images, etc., that are shown of it, the civil rights movement, its response, black American response, white American response to it, to slavery, also in South Africa, the apartheid system. You know, these are obvious, you could say, children of the early racism of the colonial peoples. If we come from there to the Islamic view, because when we're looking at Islam and racism, we have to look at the Islamic view in this regard. And the Islamic view, first and foremost, comes from the Quran. This is our major source of understanding or definition or clarification as to what is the view of Islam on anything. We start with the Quran. What we find in the Quran are general verses which talk about the variety amongst humankind in such a general way as to make the reader or the listener understand that it is just a part and parcel of the greatness of Allah in His creation. There is nothing special about people's colors because it exists everywhere. So we find, for example, in Surah Ar-Rum, the 30th chapter of the Quran, verse 22, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلْقُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافُ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ وَأَلْوَانِكُمْ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِلْعَالِمِينَ. And among His signs, among Allah's signs, is the creation of the heavens and the earth, and the variations in your languages and your colors. Indeed, in that are signs for those who know. In that are signs for the knowledgeable, the scholars, al-alimin. We also find in Surah Fatir, the 35th chapter, verses 27 and 28, أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ أَنزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فَأَخْرَجْنَا بِهِ ثَمَرَاتٍ مُخْتَلِفًا أَلْوَانُهَا. Can you not see that Allah sends down rain from the sky, and I produce from it fruit of various colors? وَمِنَ الْجِبَالِ جُدَدٌ بِيضٌ وَحُمَرٌ مُخْتَلِفٌ أَلْوَانُهَا وَغَرَابِيبُ سُودٌ. And from the mountains, red and white streaks of various colors and jet black. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ وَالدَّوَابِّ وَالْأَنْعَامِ مُخْتَلِفٌ أَلْوَانُهُ كَذَلِكَ. And likewise, among people, animals, and cattle, there is a variation in color. إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ غَفُورٌ. It is only the scholars, the knowledgeable, those who know among His slaves who truly fear Allah. Indeed, Allah is almighty and oft forgiving. So in these verses, as I said, Allah points out these variations in colors as existing in the mountains. When you look at the colors of the rocks of the mountains, there are various streaks of colors in there, sometimes reddish, sometimes whitish, and sometimes jet black. And In the same time, we also find this kind of variation where? Among people, among animals, and among cattle. We don't make special distinctions among the cattle and the animals because of their colors. No, we look at their characteristics and their qualities, not their colors. We may favor one color over another color, but we don't inherently say that white cats are better than black cats. No. That's something which varies from place to place, people to people, etc., in preference. So Allah puts it on the same level. It is nothing to be proud of. In fact, it is all from the greatness of Allah's creation. As He said, He is the Almighty, capable of doing whatever He wishes. Creating similarities like this among people, among all aspects of His creation, even in the beetles, in the insects, in all the various ranges of creation, we find these color differences. So this is not an issue for which people should take positions of superiority. Then if we look after that, because for Muslims again, for us to understand what is the position of Islam, we shift from there to what the Prophet ﷺ had to say concerning these matters of color, etc. And what we find is some very clear statements of the Prophet ﷺ, in which he, for example, on the farewell pilgrimage, he states in no uncertain terms that there is no superiority of an Arab over a non-Arab, or of a black over a white, or a white over a black. Indeed, the superiority lies only in the fearing of God. This is where superiority lies. And the Prophet ﷺ also instructed people, saying, with regards to their ancestry, let people stop boasting about their ancestors. One is only a pious believer or a miserable sinner. All men are sons of Adam, and Adam came from dust. That's the bottom line. All human beings have a common origin. Also, we find the Prophet ﷺ talking about the pride which people may take in their ancestry or their race, etc. And he said, whoever has pride in his heart equal to the weight of an atom will not enter paradise. Whoever has pride in his heart, in his or her heart, equal to an atom, in some narrations, a mustard seed, will not enter paradise. That is a very forceful statement. And furthermore, what we find as another supportive verse from the Quran, we find the famous verse in Surah Al-Hujurat, verse 13, wherein Allah lays down the criteria for superiority, which was mentioned in some of the statements of the Prophet ﷺ. Allah said there, Ya ayyuha an-nas, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha, wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qaba'ila lita'arafu, inna akramakum inda Allahi atqakum, inna Allaha alimun khabir. O humankind, most certainly it is I who have created you all from a single pair of male and female. And it is I who have made you into nations and tribes, that you may recognize each other, not despise each other. Indeed, the noblest of you in the sight of Allah is he who is most pious. Indeed, Allah is all-knowing, all-aware. So Allah here gave the criterion of piety as the means of superiority. That any other claim to superiority, which is based on color, family, tribe, etc., is rejected. As the Prophet ﷺ said regarding nationalistic and tribalistic calls to rally, for people to rally under this call, he said, "Da'ha fa innaha muntina." Give it up, leave it, because it is rotten. He said, "Man da'a ila al-'asabiyya fa laysa minna." Whoever calls to nationalism, to tribalism, is not of us. Not a true Muslim, not a follower of the message of Islam. So, when we look at that verse, which forms the basis of what Prophet Muhammad said regarding issues of race and tribe, etc., we see that Allah addresses in this verse all of humankind. It's not restricted only to the believers. He says, "Ya ayyuhan nas." So this is a statement clarifying for humankind as a whole. With regards to Muslims and the brotherhood of Muslims, that's what they're known. Allah said elsewhere, "Innama al-mu'minuna ikhwa." The believers are one brotherhood. But this goes beyond the issue of belief. It goes to the realities of humankind. So Allah says there, "O people, O humankind." And then He addresses their origin to bring them back down to the common reality. We're all from one parent. And modern anthropology supports this. It identifies, to what degree we can say it is accurate, it identifies the common origin of humankind to a woman in West Africa and to a male in East Africa. Genetically, those who study the science of anthropology through genetics, etc., this is what they have concluded. And there are many programs which have been produced on it showing how people came from there and spread over the rest of the world. So this is the fact of the matter. And furthermore, when we even look at the issues of race and distinction that people try to make with race, what we find is that Allah has left in our midst a sign to us that we are, in fact, one regardless of what we look like on the outside. Reality is that if a person from the north of Europe, the whitest of white, is ill and they need a blood transfusion and they are O negative, the rest of his family is O positive. His community, there is no O negatives there. The blood of his own family and his community can't save his life. However, somebody who may be the blackest of black, from the south of India, that person who looks the complete opposite of that person from the north of Europe, whitest of white, but that person from the south of India, blackest of black, who is O negative, his blood can save that man's life. Is this not a sign from God? Is this not an obvious sign for our times? Obviously, before this, it wasn't known. Before the issues of blood transfusion, this was not an issue. Nobody knew about this sign. Because before that time, this sign wasn't relevant, wasn't important. But for our times, where science is what we use to determine right and wrong, here is the sign Allah has left in our own bodies. As He said, within yourselves the signs are there if you seek it. So Allah has left within us that sign to confirm to us that we are one human race. We are one human race. Islam, in practice, has always taught that. It has always conveyed that message to humankind. Because one may say, okay, the Quran doesn't speak about race and superiority, etc., but what about Muslims in history? from the first generations on down. What we find is, in fact, from among the Prophet's closest companions, people of varying backgrounds. Bilal, after whom my name comes. Bilal was an Abyssinian slave who was tortured, and he became a Muslim whilst he was a slave. Later he was freed. The Prophet elevated him, had him climb on top of the Kaaba and make the call to prayer. And he was known as the caller to prayer of the Prophet. Furthermore, the Prophet, he had a slave who was given to him by his wife, by the name of Zayd ibn al-Haritha. And he was dark complexioned, also black. This slave who was with him, lived in the house with him, was treated so well, so fairly, so lovingly and so kindly, that when his father tracked him down, because he had been captured and put into slavery, and his father finally tracked him down and came to the Prophet ﷺ and asked the Prophet ﷺ if he could buy back his freedom, the Prophet ﷺ said, take him, you don't have to pay for him, take him. And of course, when the son Zayd ibn al-Haritha had found his father, he was overjoyed to have found his father, and they both wept in joy to having met each other again after so many years. So when the father told him, okay son, come with me, let us go now, Muhammad, may God's peace and blessing be upon him, he said, you can go with me. And he was a non-Muslim. Zayd said to him, no father, I would prefer to stay with the Prophet. Father was aghast. What? You would prefer to remain a slave in this man's household than come with your own father? He said, yes. The father said, obviously, he must be treating you like a father. And truly he was. When the father left him, knowing that he was in good hands, Prophet Muhammad, may God's peace and blessing be upon him, freed him. This was the obvious outward technical freedom, but already he was free in his house. He just hadn't thought about it as an issue. So when it became an issue, he said, you're free. He declared his freedom. Not only did he declare his freedom, he adopted him as his own son. Can we have a better example? Can we have a better example of a complete lack of racism? That was the example of Prophet Muhammad. May God's peace and blessings be upon him. And he made his son, Zayd's son, Usama ibn Zayd, he made him a general over the armies of the Muslims. While he was still a teenager, having under his command the caliphs, Abu Bakr, Omar, Uthman and Ali were under his command. Can we have a better example? This is the example of the Prophet. May God's peace and blessings be upon him. And we find in the generations that came after him the same attitude. After the Prophet died, may God's peace and blessings be upon him, and issues arose in Arabia, while Abu Bakr was the first caliph leading the Muslims, and people started to grumble about Usama being the leader of the army because he was young. Actually, they weren't arguing about or grumbling about the fact that he was black. It was about the fact that he was only about 17 years old. This is young. But Abu Bakr said, I would not change anyone who has been appointed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He wouldn't touch it. And during the caliphate of Umar ibn al-Khattab, after him, the second caliph, his own son, Abdullah ibn Umar, questioned him why he was giving a higher salary to Usama ibn Zayd than to his own son, Abdullah. Why? So, Umar answered what? Umar said, radiallahu anhu, my son, I do so because I know well that Allah's messenger loved Usama's father more than he loved your father. You hear that? Because I know well that Allah's messenger loved Usama's father, that's Zayd ibn Haritha. He loved him more than he loved me, your father. And he loved Usama more than he loved you. So Umar ibn al-Khattab didn't consider for a moment any change in the status which Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had afforded Zayd ibn al-Haritha and his son Usama ibn Zayd. And on one occasion, when people were speaking about Bilal, he said, Bilal, this is Umar ibn al-Khattab again, speaking about Bilal ibn Rabah, saying, Bilal is our master. And he was emancipated by our master Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr is the one, first caliph, who freed him. And he referred to him as Bilal is our master. He didn't hesitate to do that. But let me say at the same time that the companions of the Prophet, may God's peace and blessings be upon him, were human beings. And there were a rare few occasions when some of them did express some prejudice in this regard. And on one occasion, Abu Dharr ibn al-Ghaffari, who the Prophet ﷺ promised would be among the people of paradise, Abu Dharr, in a fit of anger, he called Bilal, in a negative sense, you son of a black woman. In a negative sense, he was the son of a black woman, in reality. But he used the terms in a negative sense. When the Prophet ﷺ heard that, he turned to Abu Dharr and said, "Ant rajulun fik al jahiliya." You are a man in whom the beliefs of the time of ignorance remains. There is ignorance in you. And he was very angry. These are the times when the Prophet ﷺ was angry, and it was visible in his face. Anger over injustice. So when Abu Dharr realized that, realized the error, because these things happen, comes out of people's mouths without thinking, he immediately put his head on the ground in front of Bilal and said, I will not lift my head until you walk over it. And in those days, one might say, what's the big deal about walking over somebody's head? This was a symbol of humility. You have been humbled, so much so that your master, those who are over you, walk over your head. Bilal said, no, it's okay. No, it's all right. You know, I know you have made the error and you are repentant. You know, I don't hold you for it. You don't have to do that. Please don't. In fact, Bilal refused to step over his head. Abu Dharr refused. He said, by Allah, I'm not going to lift my head until you step over it. Meaning, if you don't, I'm going to be lying here for God knows how long. So in order to relieve him of that guilt, to help him relieve himself of the guilt, Bilal walked over his head. This happened among the companions of the Prophet. May God's peace and blessing be upon him. In the generations to come, what we find is a variety of examples when we look at the great scholars of Islam. Those who studied under the companions of the Prophet, may God's peace and blessings be upon him, known as the Tabi'un. Many of them were former slaves who were black. Slaves from varying other backgrounds, non-Arabs. And they were narrators of the traditions of the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were the teachers of Abu Hanifa, the teachers of Imam Malik, the teachers of Ahmad ibn Hanbal and Ash-Shafi'i, the great scholars of Islam. They were their teachers. And they were their students. And on down through the generations. And this is how Islam has been. It showed practically that there really is no superiority based on color or race. The leading scholars of hadith, for anyone who studies the science of hadith, which is the second most noble science after the sciences of the Quran for any Muslim to study, the leading narrators, compilers of hadith were non-Arabs. Ibn Majah, An-Nasa'i, Al-Bukhari, and so on and so forth, were non-Arabs. And this has been the tradition. And we can find in our times people seeing that and being moved by that to become Muslims. For example, in the statements of Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali, formerly known as Cassius Clay, the boxer from America. He said, "The pilgrimage to Mecca was an exhilarating experience to see people belonging to different colors, races, and nationalities. Kings, heads of states, and ordinary men from very poor countries, all clad in two simple white sheets, praying to God without any sense of either pride or inferiority. It was a practical manifestation of the concept of equality in Islam." And after him, Malcolm X, actually before him, Malcolm X, he had observed the same thing when he went on Hajj. He came back saying, "Never have I witnessed such sincere hospitality and the overwhelming spirit of true brotherhood as is practiced by people of all colors and races here in this ancient holy land. The home of Abraham, Muhammad, and all of the prophets of the Holy Scriptures. For the past week, I have been utterly speechless and spellbound by the graciousness I see displayed all around me by people of all colors." And when he returned to America, and the press met him and asked him about his opinions, his changes that have taken place, if there were any changes in his views, he said, one of the key factors that he said was that "I can see that the only solution for racism in America is Islam. The only solution for racism," he's speaking about America, but it was worldwide, "is Islam. Because Christianity had a tradition in America of black churches and white churches. And even in the white churches, which allowed blacks, they would have to be in the back, somewhere off, you know, not sitting with the white people. This was their tradition, as in South Africa and elsewhere. So even in the religion, Christian religion had no basis in its teachings to deal with this sickness, this disease of racism. We also find from India, Gandhi himself saying, "The Europeans in South Africa dread the advent of Islam, as they, Muslims, claim equality with the white races. They may well dread it. If brotherhood is a sin, if it is equality of the colored races that they dread, then their dread is well founded, because that's what Islam calls to." We also have one of the Indian freedom fighters, a female by the name of Sarojini Naidu. She said, "I have been struck over and over again by this indivisible unity of Islam that makes a man instinctively a brother. When you meet an Egyptian, an Algerian, an Indian, and a Turk in London, what matters is that Egypt is the motherland of one and India is the motherland of another. That's all. They are one." So these are the observations of those who have looked at Islam from the outside as well as from within. Islam has provided the solution. And there is a story I'd like to relate to you of an individual, an American, white American by the name of Sipes, who was raised in a family of white supremacists belonging to the Ku Klux Klan, famous racist organization in America. And he talked about having joined that organization from he was 14 years till he was 21. And he became a high-ranking official in the Klan. He was involved in recruiting, etc., for it. And when he was asked about the reasons for his attitude, you know, towards black Americans, African Americans, he said because that's what everybody in his family said. This is what he grew up with. They were always referring to black people as cockroaches, violent and bad, you know, and they were just leeching off the white people. Eventually, he got involved in crime and ended up in jail. And while he was there, he had joined up with one of the racist groups in the jail because people polarize in jails, Aryan Nation. And he, at that time, though he had joined with this group for his own self-protection, he had time to read. And he started to study about racism and race and people and their origins, etc. And he started to have some doubts about what he had been raised with. And the more he read, the more doubts he started to develop. Eventually, he came out of jail and he met some Muslims. He ended up being a roommate of a black who was also a Muslim. And through the behavior, how that person as a Muslim treated him, sharing with him whatever he had, and he just couldn't understand it, why he would be so forthcoming and so sharing, it eventually won him over and he became a Muslim. From a white supremacist belonging to the Ku Klux Klan, being opened by reading, of course. That's why Allah says in the Quran that these differences in color and tongues, etc., are from the greatness of Allah and have nothing to do with superiority or pride. This is clear to those who have knowledge. To those who have knowledge. A person without knowledge moves on emotion. So they can't change. Difficult to change when what you are reacting to is a product of emotion and not knowledge. And this is why, from the Islamic perspective, back to the Quran again, we find in the Quran where Allah identifies there the beginning of racism. Where? In the creation of Adam. When Adam was created, the angels and Iblis, Satan, a leader among the jinn, were instructed to bow in recognition of Adam's special place with Allah. Iblis refused. Satan refused. And when he was questioned as to why, he said, "Ana khayrun minhu, khalaqtani min narin wa khalaqtahu min teen." I'm better than him, Adam. That man that you want me to bow before. I'm better than him because you created me from fire. The jinn are created from fire. And you created him from clay. That is that expression of racism. You see, there it is written in the Quran. As something evil, which led to God's curse, God's eternal curse on Satan. Pride based on racial, tribal origin is a cursed state, displeasing and hated by God. And that is how it is mentioned in the Quran. And that is why Islam has this great message to offer to humankind, to help them to achieve peace in this area, to bring them to the realities of humankind and human existence. Human beings are one human race. And there is only one God. And as such, God created for human beings only one message. He did not want confusion amongst people. So he didn't create a variety of messages. He created with the first human being on the earth one religion, one God, one human race, and one religion. And that religion, the religion of Adam, was submission to the will of God. Obedience to God's command. And that is what in Arabic is referred to as Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Inshallah, brothers and sisters. We will now move into the question and answer session. We encourage non-Muslims, brothers and sisters both, to ask questions, and we will give them precedence at the microphone. So if any non-Muslims are here, you will be given preference at the microphones. Please state your name and your profession before you ask your question. Thank you. You may begin, sir.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Ludovic. I'm French. I am not Muslim. And I am traveling 8 months in India. I am studying in France, but actually I take a year for me. And maybe you said the answer of my question, but forgive me if I make you repeat. But how in the Quran Allah explains the different the origin of the different kind of human, you know, black, white. I don't like the word race, but we are all different. And how is it possible that from one first man, common first man, mm-hmm. there are all these differences in the humanity?
Okay. Our friend's question basically is, how is it possible that the variety that we see amongst us here today, in terms of colors, shapes, sizes, you know, colors of eyes and everything. We see all this variety. How can it come from one person? That's a good question. Well, the geneticists, those who specialize in genetics, modern scientists in the science of genetics, they explain it very easily. Every human being has in his or her genes the ability to produce every other human being. Every human being, not just Adam the first, but even you today have the ability to produce children of varying colors and shapes and sizes, etc. It's just a matter of factors which lead to the turning on of some genes, turning off of other genes. And who controls that? God. And one of the signs that he leaves amongst us are who? The albinos. You know the albino or albino? You'll see somebody from Africa, you know, from a tribe. There's one friend of mine, a Sudanese. You know, his parents are black. His grandparents are black. His wife is black. And he is white as snow. So much so his eyelashes are white. You see, this is how. This is genetic. It has to do with the genes. So Adam, when Allah created him, and this is something that the Prophet ﷺ alluded to, when he said that when Adam was being made, and he was made from clay, the angels gathered from all over the earth different amounts of dirt. Some of it white, some of it brown, some of it black. As we have all this variation in the colors of the earth, in the earth itself, that was all brought together in the creation of Adam.
JazakAllah.
Pleasure. I hope that answered your question. Now I'll go to the microphone in the back.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Nawaz Satwilkar and I'm an electronic engineer working at Siemens. My question is, here in India we have a concept of Sayyids. They claim the ancestry to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they say that Sayyids marry only Sayyids, or the other concept is like the Sayyids never has to be given zakat. So please throw some light on this.
Okay, our brother has asked about a concept amongst Muslims, especially in the subcontinent, regarding people who are given the label of Sayyids, Sayyid, with the claim that they are descendants of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's family. This is the claim. Of course, any such claim, first and foremost we say, must be supported by evidence. Please trace your ancestry right back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for me. And most of these people, in fact, 99.99% of these people cannot do that. They can't trace it back. It's just a claim which was made a few generations back and people accepted it and it was handed down. That's the first point. Really, it is false in most cases. Secondly, the idea that only Sayyids marry Sayyids, that is also false. Even if we accept them as being from the family of the Prophet, descendants of the Prophet's family, the idea that they only marry amongst each other, that is false. Islam doesn't support that at all. That is tribalism. And that's what the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man da'a ila al-asabiyya falaysa minna." Whoever calls to tribalism, to only my family, is not of us. So even the practice among some Muslims today in ignorance, where they say you cannot marry outside of our family. You know, as an Indian, you can't marry a Pakistani. Or even within, from Hyderabad, you can't marry people from Tamil Nadu. You know, this is nonsense. This is completely outside of Islam. Islam is innocent from these kinds of beliefs and ideas. Completely false. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam demonstrated that when he married Zayd ibn al-Haritha, a former black slave, to Zainab, his own cousin, who was from top families of Mecca. He did it to demonstrate that those kinds of feelings and attitudes have no place in Islam. Third point. There are people who are from the family of the Prophet, may God's peace and blessings be upon him, among his very uncles, who Allah said are people of hell. Among his own uncles, much closer to him than any of the Sayyids today could possibly be, are people who have been designated as people of hell. So what does that tell us? Being a relative of the Prophet has no value. Before God, it has no value. You can be a disbeliever or a disbeliever. And truly, this is what happened. So, this practice or this belief is a part of the ignorance of Muslims. As Muslims drift away from the Islamic teachings, then these kind of racialist, tribalist, nationalistic feelings and ideas arise. This has historically been the way. When Islam is strong, the teachings are well known, people know it, then these feelings go down. They're satanic. No, as I gave the example from Iblis, Satan, refusing to bow and his claim, know that the origin of racism is from Satan. It is a satanic belief. And tribalism is satanic. Human beings are one.
I believe we have a question from the sister side. Sister, would you please state your question? And your name, please, and profession.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Maryam Sheikh. I'm student of Al Mu'mina School. You mentioned in your talk that Zaid radiallahu anhu's name was changed to Zaid ibn Muhammad after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam adopted him. Muslims generally say that adoption is not allowed in Islam. Please clarify.
Okay, as I mentioned, when Prophet Muhammad, may God's peace and blessings be upon him, freed Zaid and adopted him as his son officially by changing his name to Zaid ibn Muhammad, that remained so until Muslims reached Medina. When the Prophet reached Medina and the legal system of Islam was revealed, then Allah corrected that and said, "Ud'uhum li'aba'ihim fahuwa aqsatu indallah." Call them by their father's names. That is more just in the sight of Allah. So his name was re-corrected and changed back to Zaid ibn al-Haritha, the name of his father. So according to Islamic law, a person's family name cannot be changed. Even if he converts to Islam. For example, my name, oftentimes Muslims ask me, "Your name is Bilal Phillips. Sounds like you have a piece of this and a piece of that." You know? Half and half. If you want to be a Muslim, you should be Bilal Muhammad or something, you know? Why not? Well, the reality is that according to the Sharia, according to Islamic law, it is forbidden for anyone to change the names of their fathers. Because the fathers' names indicate their genealogy. And when a person converts to Islam, he doesn't change his genealogy. His father is still his father. So he's not allowed to change his father's name. His given name, he may change. If the meaning is un-Islamic, if it involves some aspect of idolatry, for example, you know, then that name should be changed. Like my previous given name, what they call Christian name or first name, was Dennis. Dennis comes from the Greek god Dionysius, the god of wine and bacchanal, you know. So that is definitely not an acceptable name. Like Diana, the goddess of love. If you become a Muslim, you have to change Diana. You know, or Apollo, or any of these names of gods, etc. These names have to be changed. You know, or if the name has a bad meaning, also the Prophet ﷺ used to change people's given names, not their family names. Even if the family name has a bad meaning, right, he would not touch it. Like Abu Huraira, very famous companion of the Prophet, may God's peace and blessings be upon him, who narrated more hadiths than any other companion. His original name was Sakhr ibn Abd al-Shams. Sakhr means rock. The son of the sun worshipper. His father's name was sun worshipper or slave of the sun. Now the Prophet ﷺ changed his name, his given name, to Abdurrahman. And he was given the nickname Abu Huraira, the man who loved the cat. He used to carry a little cat around with him. He liked kittens. But his name was changed, only his first name was changed to Abdurrahman, from Rocky, you have a name like Rocky, then we say, better you change it. Get some name which is, you know, more attractive, something of better meaning, etc. Otherwise, names, family names should not be touched. So, in answer to the question, is there adoption in Islam? Yes. You may adopt somebody, but you can't change their name. Adopting meaning looking after them, taking care of them, raising them, spending money on them, you know, providing for them. Of course, Islam encourages that, especially for orphans. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ praised those who looked after orphans, saying that they will be like this with me on the Day of Judgment in Paradise. So, looking after orphans is something highly encouraged in Islam. Adopting them is a wonderful thing, but don't change their names.
Thank you, Dr. Phillips. Brother, go ahead now.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
My name is Lim Jui Sun from Malaysia. I have a simple question to Brother Bilal Phillips. The Jew claim that they are the most superior human beings on earth, better than any other races. What the Quran speak about this? What the Quran say about the Jew? The Jew claim they are the most superior human being on earth.
Okay.
What Quran speak about? Talk about that.
You see, to answer that question, we would have to establish that this is a fact. That the Jews claim that they are the most superior people on earth. So unless you can quote from me from the Talmud or from the Torah, where the Jews actually say that, then for me to answer your question is to accept your premise without evidence. Right? That is to accept your premise without evidence. But let me go on. If it were that they did say that, okay, we'll just take it. So if they did say it, does it have any weight from the Quranic perspective? No, it has no weight. Allah has already stated, as I mentioned the verse in Surah Al-Hujurat, 49th chapter, verse 13, Allah says there very clearly, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. Indeed, the best of you, the most superior of you, are those who fear God the most. So that is the only criterion that we have. And only Allah knows who fears Him the most. He knows what is in the hearts, because obviously fear of God meaning fear of His displeasure, which leads one to do what He commands. Who knows that best? Allah, because He knows what's in the hearts.
Thank you for your question. I'll take the question from the brother here.
My name is J.V. Gadri. I am a Hindu. You quoted that Aryans are superior race. According to my knowledge, Aryans are not a superior race. It is quality they developed in their life for generation. That is for quality. Aryans represent for quality, not race.
Well, I am not quite clear exactly the point you're trying to make. What I did say, and I didn't say that Aryans or Aryans are superior, I just said that they, according to history, you know, came into India and conquered it. And they came from the north. They were not original Indians. The original Indians are the Dravidians. So when they came and they conquered, they set up a system with themselves on top, which is natural. Any conqueror, if he conquers, this is the normal course of history. Whenever you conquer a people, you put them under you. They're your subjects. So that's what they did. And the caste system, you know, evolved out of that relationship, which had to do with organization for economics and variety of other reasons. This is all I was saying. But now it has become related or appears related to race or color.
This will be the last question. Brother, please.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Suhail Firfire. I'm in the field of marketing.
There's a group of people I've come across among Muslims who strongly adhere to the Quran and the Sunnah. They say that the Khilafah, or a ruler in Islam or amongst Muslims in the future, should be from amongst the Quraysh. I went on to read some references in Sahih Muslim. I didn't get any proper explanations on that. The Hadith kept saying that the ruler should be from the Quraysh. Could you please throw some light on that?
Okay, this issue of Al-A'immatu min Quraysh, that the Imams, the leaders, should be chosen from the Quraysh. This was a recommendation attributed to Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, based on the fact that the Quraysh tribe was the leading tribe of Arabia, and that for organizational purposes, if the other tribes would not submit except to one from the Quraysh. So scholars looking at that, you know, have concluded different conclusions regarding it, whether it is forever or whether it is just for the first generation where that issue of the Quraysh and the other tribes of Arabia was relevant. Because after that period of time, we know in Muslim history, they weren't. Right? They weren't. So it is a point which seemed to be for political organization in the first few generations only, and not a general statement until Yawm al-Qiyamah.
Okay, thank you. That was the last question, inshallah.